Welcome, dear viewers. I, Dr. Maitri Shinde, take immense pleasure on discussing the topic research methodology. Now, when we come to the question of what is meant by research, as the word says, research means search, search for knowledge, search for some kind of information. So, every day in our day-to-day life, we come across so many questions, we have so many problems, we have so much of inquisitiveness in our mind. So, to overcome all these, we try to find answers to all of these, and research is precisely to find answers to all the questions and to find solutions to the problems that we face on a day-to-day basis. The facts of today have been research of the yesteryears. For example, when we use our mobile phones, we have everything available at our fingertips. We can avail the opportunity of having everything at our doorstep with just operating our mobile, sitting at whichever place possible. So, research, when we look at the definition of research, it is the systematic investigation into and study of materials and sources in order to establish facts and reach new conclusions. Now, when we talk about why research, why is it that people pursue research? Why is it that people are inquisitive about finding new information or finding facts? Now, these are the few reasons that I thought would be best to discuss. First one is to acquire a research degree, either a PhD or an MPhil degree. It could be for promotion from one level, somebody wants to escalate their stance to another next level. That could be one of the reasons. Another reason, quest for knowledge, somebody who is an ardent learner, somebody who is an ardent finder of knowledge has this appetite for research. Then people who are inquisitive, the passion for research is another thing. And then there are people who also find immense joy or immense pleasure in doing research. Now, coming on to the next slide, we have the objectives of research. Now, we have listed out a couple of objectives. Research extends knowledge. A particular information which has not been delved into, or an information which was not thought about, you know, can be brought out in the open when we talk about research. Then it establishes generalizations. When we talk about generalization, say for example, you know, the theory of evolution, Darwin's theory, all these eventually when we pursue our research, we try to establish the already existing generalizations. Coming to the fourth point, it verifies the existing facts and theories. There are so many facts, so many theories across every discipline. Every discipline is an ocean. So when we take one discipline and we try to narrow that down to one particular topic or one particular theme, that theme itself becomes an ocean where we can connect that particular theme to different facts and the different theories that are already existing and work on them. It also enables to develop new theories and concepts. With the existing facts, with the existing concepts, how is it that we can add on to the existing theory and to the concepts and then create our own theory or concept? This all depends on our interest or our passion for looking at a subject or a discipline from multiple perspectives. Now, analyze previous and the new. What do we understand by analyze previous and the new? The ones that are already existing, the ones that have already been established, and then the one that you want to formulate, a new theory, a new concept. So, how do we connect these two concepts and try to relate them to the contemporary situation is one more important objective of research. Analyze interrelationships. how important it is to analyze interrelationships, a theory that was built way back centuries ago, and now you built upon a new theory. How is it that you're trying to establish interrelationships between these two is so very important. Coming to the next point, we have research providing solutions to problems. Research, of course, provides solutions to so many problems, especially in the fields of social sciences, in the fields of medicine, in the fields of, you know, the societal issues. So, research precisely finds solutions to so many problems. And then lastly, research certainly has to contribute towards society building. If our research is not contributing towards a society, then I think the research would just be confined to the textbooks, or research would just be confined to the papers, to your research theses. Now, let's move on to the next slide. We have approaches to research. I have jotted down two important approaches. One is a quantitative research and the other the qualitative one. Now, let us look at what do we mean by quantitative research. When we talk about quantitative research, it is all about numerical values, or it is all about numbers. Say, for example, we have a couple of students where we are trying to find out their communication skills levels. Now, we try to take different variables or different parameters to find out their communication levels. Now, say for example, if we take a class of 50, now we can take a couple of parameters like, are these students coming from urban background, from semi-urban background, from the rural background? How many of these students are coming from the English medium background or the Telugu medium background? How many of these students have parents who have been educated? How many of these students have an exposure to English? How many of these students are good readers, good listeners, and so on and so forth? So, based on the various parameters that I have just discussed, we can come to some kind of analysis based on the observations that we make. We also can have, you know, kind of closed ended surveys or interviews, survey and interviews based on the focus groups. We can collect information or data from them and come to a conclusion as to why the language levels or the English speaking language levels of a particular batch of students is good, fairly good, or whatever it is. Moving on to the next slide, that is qualitative. Now, qualitative is something that deals with non-numerical. It is purely decided upon, you know, a plethora of, you know, the existing definitions, concepts, theories, symbols, metaphors, so on and so forth. All the language implications or the linguistic implications or the literature implications when we talk precisely in terms of language and literature. We do some kind of, now when we look at the slide, we see there is content analysis, there is interviews, narratives from focus groups, open-ended surveys in the form of, you know, a questionnaire prepared by the researcher. Now, these can be common to across disciplines, be it sciences, be it, you know, management, be it literature. Now, say for example, if we talk about management students, or when we talk about, when I want to find out the attrition rate of a particular, employees working in a particular company. Now, why is it that the attrition rate of these employees is on the higher side when compared to the employees working in a different, or say B organization? We can have different parameters, we can have different observations made, and then based on that we can arrive at some kind of qualitative research. Now, when we have talked all these about the general context in terms of research methodology and research techniques, let me narrow down my talk to literature. Before that, we'll discuss what are the different other methods in research methodology. We have the descriptive style, we have the analytical one, the applied, empirical, and fundamental. So, more than this, I would like to discuss more for the literature students. So, when we talk about research in literature, literature in research can be done from multiple angles. Say, for example, you take a text, and when you take a text, we read the text and we try to analyze from different angles, or we try to have different perspectives based on the kind of understanding we have. Now, say for example, I take a poem, say Ulysses, written by Alfred Tennyson. What are the thematic concerns when we talk about Ulysses? Ulysses as a poem can be taken as a classic poem, because Ulysses is not just talking about the Victorian period, it also reflects upon the current situations when the theme of Ulysses, of the quest for knowledge, quest for, you know, being ambitious, is taken into consideration. So, a text can be viewed from various angles when we talk about the thematic concerns. Now, when I take G.B. Shaw's Pygmalion, what are the thematic conditions when I say Pygmalion? Pygmalion, yes, when we look at the characters, a protagonist, Mr. Higgins and Eliza. How is it that, you know, Higgins is so very keen about, you know, turning Eliza into an English woman? Eliza, he considers as someone who has been taken from the gutters. Now, this thematic concerns, when we say, it's talking about the social class, the class division. It's talking about transformation of a particular person. It's talking about education. It's talking about gender concerns. So, these can be discussed. A given text can have so many different angles. Now, when we look at history, yes, a given text can be viewed from the historical background. Say, for example, when I refer to a novel like Pride and Prejudice, yes, this novel, it's talking more about, you know, how a particular mother of four women or four young women is keen on getting her daughters married to a rich man. So, what is it that took place, and why is it that, you know, the girls or the mother are so very keen on getting their daughters married to a rich man? So, this is again social class. The history of that particular nation or a particular culture is talking about it. Now, the social cultural implications. What are the socio-cultural implications? When we say, a poem like Alexander Pope's Ode on Solitude. Alexander Pope's Ode on Solitude, although written in 1700, it was written, when he was just 12 years old. He faced a kind of, discrimination because he was a Catholic. Hence, he did not want to, or he was confined to a very small place, a rural area, and he tried to find solace in that particular confinement. He did not have complaints. Maybe there was some kind of psychological displacement that Alexander Pope faced at that time, especially because he was very young, but then he tried to seek internal complacency, or, you know, he tried to be at peace with the society around, trying to find some kind of peace within himself. Now, let us take the political context. What is the political context? Now, when we look at the political context also, now say when I take a poem or when I take a text like On His Blindness, written by John Milton. Yes, John Milton talks about, or he complains about his blindness in his sonnet. The first few lines, he is very, very dejected. The tone of the poem is all about dejection, all about having lost everything in life. So he says, "Why is it that you have taken away my talent?" He complains to God. And then eventually he finds peace with himself, trying to find an answer, stating that, yes, if you have taken away my talent of seeing the world around, but I will continue, or I will be persistent in serving you. The political conditions, yes, this is, you know, he belonged to the Puritan age. The political conditions then talked about, the conflict that was there in the mind of the poet, and, you know, the conflict between the societal and the growth in terms of literary aspects. Religion. Yes, religion, again, when we talk about another theme, when we take a poem like A Psalm of Life by Wordsworth Longfellow, an American writer, yes, A Psalm of Life. Psalm, in fact, it's a biblical reference, it has a biblical implication. A psalm is song, a chapter in the Old Testament. But here, in the text, in the poem, the poet talks about how life can be treated entirely different. Something where, you know, the psalm says, man is born of dust and then goes back to dust. This particular aspect, he tried to work upon it and say that, you know, life is not just meant to be, you know, because the psalm says it begins in the dust and ends in the dust. Life is not supposed to be wasted. There is something important that we are all born for. So that is how we have to make our endeavors and then progress in life. Now, critical references. What are the critical references? Every text connects us with some theory or the other, every text for that matter. When I talk about Margaret Atwood's the poem on this is a photograph of me, she is talking about two thematic concerns, about identity crisis, about the treatment of women that was prevailing during those times. How is it that she did not make a stance, or she did not make her appearance so very vivid in the society? Another thing which is very, very important is language implications. What are the language implications that we can see in a given text? So, are we talking about the strong diction that is available in the text? Are we talking about the different figures of speech that is available in the text in terms of symbolism, in terms of metaphors, in terms of irony, so on and so forth? There are so many things that can be explored when we take a text and explore the language implications. So I think we have dealt upon a couple of important points when we talk about research in particular in literature. Now, coming on to the next slide, research process. Now, the first point, formulating the research issue or the research problem. This is something that we have to think about very, very precisely, having a keen idea or a precise idea about what we want to do. Initially, we think, I want to work on this particular topic. I say, I will work on feminism. Feminism itself is an ocean. So, what is it that you want to work on feminism, taking one particular text in mind? So, it is for us to narrow down our title and then decide what the research question is going to be, or what the research issue is going to be. Now, the second point, extensive literature survey. Read and gather as much material from journals, from articles, from newspapers, wherever you find your topic of interest in. When you gather all this, you are adding upon your knowledge bank, and you are trying to make your ground very, very strong and firm. The next point is development of working hypothesis. When we talk about the working hypothesis, we try to draw or try to refer to the possible outcomes or the possible results that our research is going to make. The next point, preparing the research design. Yes, this is something very, very important. Now, when we have a particular research title, when we are sure about what the research title is going to be, now what is it that each chapter, how am I going to decide my or divide my research into? Chapter 1 consists of what, chapter 2 consists of what, chapter 3, chapter 4 and so on and so forth. So, yes, this research design will give you some clarity as to from what point you have to go to the next level. Now, the next slide is talking about collecting data. What all is needed to collect regarding your research, whether you explore the different libraries or you reach places and you know conduct your interviews or do a survey, it should be done parallelly. Next, we have execution of the project followed by analysis of the data. You do a thorough analysis of what you have gathered, the existing information, existing theories, existing facts, concepts, definitions, and then how are you trying to relate or connect it with your findings. That is what is very, very important. And then testing your hypothesis. Eventually, as you progress in your research, how is it that you know the research hypothesis that you framed initially, how is it trying to, is it trying to relate with what is progress, or is it deviating from it? Fine if it deviates, that means you have found a different way to, or you have found a different area where your interest goes. So, then generalizations, you're establishing generalizations and then trying to foreground your research very, very promptly. And then finally, it is preparation of your report. Writing your report is very, very important. As you pursue your research, as you do your work, it's very, very important that you parallelly write what your work and how your work is progressing. And then coming to the later slide, we have qualities of a good research. What are the qualities of a good research? Now, when we look at the previous definition, what is research? We said it is a systematic and scientific findings of information and knowledge and all that. So, it is supposed to be systematically done. Every research has a plan, has a design, and hence it has to be systematically done, logical. No research is based on arbitrary facts. It has to be based on logic. And then empirical. What do we mean by empirical? Again, when we say, research is something which should be based on facts, experience of something, experience of the findings, experience of our analysis is something which qualifies a good research. And finally, replicable. Replicable, any research that is sustainable and can be used for further research or further studies is certainly a good quality research.